AMD's RX Vega isn't even out yet, but already has an extensive and very interesting history. We first learned of the chip in March of 2016 from a roadmap that showed Vega and Navi for the first time. Interestingly, this was just days after rumours of a GeForce 1000 series, putting a release date of May that year. Now, roadmaps aren't meant to be taken literally, pixel for pixel, but it was pretty clear from this that Vega would arrive after Nvidia's 1000 series. Polaris also ended up coming out a month after, but was never intended to compete with the high end. Instead, it did a nice job of covering the low to mid end of the market, with better power efficiency than older AMD designs. The relation between Vega and Polaris was never made entirely clear. Normally you get a new architecture that replaces the older one, but AMD's strategy changed a bit with Vega. It wasn't intended to replace Polaris, but rather to complement it as a follow-up family, presumably to bridge the time gap between Polaris and Navi. Since Polaris would take the low to mid-end, and Vega the high, it wasn't even out of the question that Vega could complete the 400 series lineup, perhaps being called the 490, as was expected following the naming schemes of previous AMD generations. But AMD never officially said anything about that, and as we all now know, Vega didn't become the 490. Polaris later got re-released as the 500 series, the 90 performance tier was never reintroduced, and still, Vega was nowhere to be seen. Like I said, roadmaps aren't meant to be taken literally, pixel for pixel. But if you did do that, a few interesting things happen. Firstly, the pixels here indicate a Vega release at the end of 2016 or early 2017. Secondly, Vega's positioning makes it out to be the most ahead of its time compared with the other architectures listed. Of course, we now all know that the actual launch in August of 2017 puts it a lot more in line with the others, if the performance per watt is still to be believed. A 2017 release was also hinted at way back in May 2016, where at a JP Morgan conference, Ruth mentions a follow-up to the Polaris in 2017. This is assumed to be Vega, judging from the roadmap she referenced. And later on in 2016, they said they would launch Vega in the first half of 2017. And Vega was indeed officially announced on January the 5th, 2017, though not before some interesting teaser information was released about it. The previous December, Star Wars Battlefront 2 Rogue One was officially shown running on Vega, and although no FPS figures were shown, Lisa herself said that it was running at 4K at greater than 60fps. What was more interesting, and a lot more controversial, was Technological's video which showed Vega running Doom at 4K. This time, the FPS was shown. Its score placed it at, or slightly above, the GeForce 1080, which, let's not forget, had already been out for 6 months at this point, so it was easy for people to compare it. And people did, and were downvoted and mocked for it. And who could forget the countdown? On January the 1st, AMD released a video on their YouTube channel called After the Uprising. The video itself showed a boy with a drum walking around for a while before finding lots of drums and being very happy about it. But the video also doubled up as a teaser for Vega, and is where the "make some noise" and "poor Volta" memes come from. It linked to the announcement countdown, which ended on January the 5th. I think people were expecting the announcement to include a release date or some benchmarks from this, but we mostly got talks about Vega's design and how new and improved it was. The closest we got to a benchmark was another video of Doom running at 4K. We had already had this the month before, but I think that this one is more important since it was shown from AMD themselves. I don't think it's too unreasonable to believe that it was chosen to show Vega in the best possible light. Oh, and we also got the making of that drum video. But as well as the new Doom benchmark, a few days prior to Vega's official announcement, we also got an FPS demo of Star Wars. Since it was locked at 60, we can't see how much higher it could achieve, but it did occasionally dip below that figure. These both indicated performance slightly above that of the GeForce 1080 and were topic of hot debate. On one hand, you could say that these were hand-picked games and demos to show Vega at its strongest. But on the other, you could argue that they were using early drivers that could be improved a lot more before release day. Some speculated that AMD was sandbagging, where they deliberately underplay how good their graphics cards are. This would keep Nvidia guessing and would give us all a nice surprise come launch day. But Adore TV stated that if they were sandbagging, then they had only just started using that strategy with the official announcement. It's true, when AMD has a good product, they've always proudly shouted about it. And why shouldn't they? Vega's silence until just weeks before its actual release is a very different story. Anyway, Adult TV concluded that overclocked 1080 performance, so many months later, wasn't good enough. Now I like what Adult TV did. He got existing information about the product, then used common sense and reason to come to a level-headed conclusion about Vega, which I think is smart. Even if I were to disagree with his conclusion, at least I could see where he was coming from. But since Vega's announcement, I've been amazed with the creativity I've seen in the community. The mental gymnastics required to dismiss or to downright contradict the evidence we're presented with is truly next level stuff. AMD and Nvidia are truly blessed to have such a devout and blindly loyal fanbase. I'm sure these are only the loud minority, but they really have made some noise this year, and is part of the reason why the information leading up to Vega's release is so fascinating to cover. At the end of February, at GDC 2017's Capsaicin and Cream event, they announced that Vega's official name would be RX Vega. I mean, AMD didn't promise any sort of announcement, but you can understand the community would have excitedly watched that, hoping for a bit more than they got. Then, mid-May, we saw Vega running Sniper Elite 4 at around 60fps, some bits faster, some bits slower, which Adore TV stated as being roughly 10% slower than an overclocked GeForce 1080. Once again, rather than to simply argue for what he wants to be true, he instead uses framerates from the AMD events and comparable Nvidia systems to help reach this conclusion. Later, at the end of May during the Computex press conference, Prey was shown running at 4K using Threadripper and two Vegas. This could be argued that it was to show off Threadripper and that the two graphics cards were there to represent a super enthusiast rig. This didn't stop the showcase from being a topic of deep Reddit discussions, where individuals tried to calculate the FPS from the tearing present in the stream, which I thought was a pretty cool idea. But why did AMD have to use Crossfire on a game that could just about be handled using a single 1080? The presentation ended with Lisa announcing that the
Radeon RX Vega will be launched at SIGGRAPH at the end of July in Los Angeles.
But then, at that event, it was revealed that it wouldn't be launched until August the 14th, 2 weeks later. But AMD did still hold up their earlier promise of Vega in the first half of 2017 because the Frontier Edition came out on June the 27th, 3 days before the half-one deadline. But although still Vega, the FE is designed with professionals in mind, and its higher price puts it out of reach of most gamers. Still, you'd think this would have been the end of it, that reviewers could have just benchmarked this and gotten answers to Vega's performance once and for all. And if you must know, in games it was found to be somewhere between the GeForce 1070 and 1080, depending on the title. Which is disappointing, and if anything, even lower than what we saw back in January. But it isn't that simple. I'll explain how performance could improve in a bit, but right now I want to cover how the RX Vega is being marketed, because it's quite clever. It's been showcased in a number of places next to an Nvidia setup. The audience isn't told which is which, only that the Nvidia one is more expensive. I'm guessing they want both systems to feel identical so that they can say, see, you can get the same experience for less money with AMD. We're not told which Vega or GeForce cards are being used, so this has been a topic of speculation as well. They've also moved away from comparing average frame rates and towards minimums. This was even hinted to on Poor Volta, though I'm probably reading too much into that. But still, I don't like this changed approach to benchmarking. Not because it's the wrong thing to do, I'm sure there's a lot to be learned from comparing minimums in this way, but because it implies that they had to make this change to make Vega seem better, whether that's the case or not. As usual, the graphs aren't to scale and unusual cutoffs are used, like 40 and 48 Hz, which conveniently place Nvidia below and AMD above. It's worth noting that this figure isn't even the cutoff point for either FreeSync or G-Sync. There are monitors for both technologies that can go down as low as 30. Plus, the way the graphs are done implies that the previous gen Fury X has faster minimums than the GeForce 1080. Even if that's the case, there's something suspicious going on here. The 1080 is undisputedly a much faster card. They shouldn't even be compared to, so seeing the Fury X as being 20% better makes me question the testing methods rather than the results, and I think only serves to undermine the message that AMD's trying to get across with this slide. Regardless of what happens though, there's no such thing as a bad card, only a bad price. And we now know that the RX Vega starts off at just $399. A little late to the party, perhaps. And maybe not much consolation for people who have held off upgrading in the hopes that Vega would be a Pascal killer. But there are some good points that need mentioning. Firstly is FreeSync. I disagree with Nvidia's closed and expensive G-Sync technology, so I think it's great that so many monitors are instead choosing to adopt FreeSync, which AMD openly supports. And as resolutions and game requirements progress, then there will be an increased demand for GPUs faster than the 580 with support for FreeSync. And Vega will finally give people an option for this. Secondly are the bundle offers. And these have really surprised me because they make complete sense. You spend an extra $100 on the Vega cards to get these bundles, but with them you can get $100 off a Ryzen 7 MOBO combo, $200 off a specific FreeSync monitor, and two free games, which according to AMD comes to a dank total of $420 saved. Or $320 if you factor in the extra $100 you have to spend to get the bundle in the first place. If I was in the market for an entirely new system, then this would certainly be very appealing to me. Just bear in mind that the monitor deal isn't available in most places, and that this particular model appears to have some issues with FreeSync. Oh dear. And the third trick that Vega may have up its sleeve is the possibility of AMD Finewine. Super ripe Finewine. I don't like to buy something in the hope that it gets better in the future, but there's something very exciting known as tile-based rasterization that has the potential to massively improve gaming performance. is a feature that Nvidia has had for several generations, but until now has been missing from AMD GPUs. But Vega has support for it. It hasn't been enabled yet, but AMD says it will be for all Vega GPUs come the RX's release date on August the 14th, as well as some power saving features absent from the Frontier edition. I very much hope that the delays have been so that AMD can ready these features for release day and that they can improve these cards. Like I said, I don't like buying into something in the hope that it gets better in the future, but there is at least a glimmer of hope that we haven't seen the full potential of the Vega cards just yet. Honestly, I'm tired of all the waits and teasers and hopes that there's some secret tech that AMD's waiting to unleash. Right now, all I want are proper benchmarks and reasonable prices, as this will benefit everyone. Except Nvidia.